Welcome back. My name is Joe Sudbay, guest hosting for Mike, and couldn't be happier right now to be joined by the political director at Daily Kos, David Neer. Welcome back to the show, David.
Joe, always a pleasure.
Well, I'm looking forward to it. We have a lot of ground to cover. And something I'd like to start with, Raymond from Michigan just called in and was asking about the filibuster and what Democrats can do on the filibuster. What will they do? And I know this is something that you have monitored closely and your colleagues have at Daily Kos. What's your latest thinking about how Senate Democrats are proceeding on taking action on the filibuster?
So I think the most interesting development is what we saw recently with Joe Manchin. And Manchin, of course, is the key to a lot of this because he's sort of the most conservative when it comes to Senate procedures. He has said that eliminating the filibuster would be, to quote his exact words, bullshit. And he's generally been very, but he did say just in the past week or so that he thought that the filibuster should be somewhat painful. Right now, the way the filibuster works is that pretty much, if you're a Republican senator, you just say, we're filibustering this, period, end of story. But what Joe Manchin wants to do is restore this notion of a talking filibuster, which is sort of the popular conception of the filibuster. This is how people think it works, because everyone knows about Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, where basically you have to stand on your feet for, you know, hours and hours on end. And if you slip up or if no one else is willing to take the baton from you, then boom, the filibuster is over. And if we move to that sort of system, then I think that we have made a huge amount of progress. Because maintaining that talking filibuster where you're just standing endlessly and you can't go to the bathroom, you're going to mess up eventually. And you're going to mess up either in one of two ways. One, it's going to be just a horrible spectacle to have Republican after Republican standing up there blocking the John Lewis's vision for restoring voting rights in America. And two, you're going to mess up and you're going to, you know, take too long of a break, or the guy you think is going to fill in for you isn't actually there. And then, like I said, the filibuster is over, and then you get to vote on a simple majority vote. So if we can move in that direction, then I think we can make a lot of progress.
Really important. And of course, one of the most important pieces of legislation that's coming up soon in the Senate will be the For the People Act and the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. And they are so important, David, because of what we're seeing around the country. And, you know, you and I and many of your colleagues, Carolyn Fiedler and others, pay such close attention to state legislatures and the power that state legislatures have. And one of the things I always maintain is Republicans do a couple of things with state legislatures, but one is they figure out ways to restrict voting participation. They do it through gerrymandering. They do it through strict voter suppression laws. And that's what we're seeing happening around the country right now in many states.
Yeah, there are literally hundreds of bills have been filed in Republican-run legislatures across the country, simply designed to make it harder to vote. And they're not even being subtle about this. They're not even trying to hide what they want to do. And the reality is that, you know, if some of these bills pass, they might be, you know, targeted by lawsuits. But plenty of them will simply take effect as law unless Congress does something about it. And you were mentioning the For the People Act, also known as H.R. 1. It's been called H.R. 1 by Democrats in the past two Congresses because they want to give it the symbolic importance. This is our number one bill. And it would do just so many, so many different things to really reverse this ongoing GOP war on voters in the states and expand and protect voting rights. One of the most interesting is that it would essentially outlaw congressional gerrymandering and require states to use independent commissions following basically nonpartisan criteria on how to create new maps. They couldn't draw maps to favor one party or the other. So this would apply to both sides equally. And if Democrats can pass H.R. 1, it will really have far-reaching impacts, but I think it will also dramatically change the calculus about 2022. You know, the conventional wisdom, of course, is that it's a midterm election. Democrats will probably suffer. But if Republicans can't draw crooked maps, then I think that changes a lot of things.
Right. And they are counting on crooked maps. And they actually think that if they are able to manipulate the existing, they can gerrymander without, you know, this federal legislation preventing them. They think that they could pick up enough seats just through that alone to take back the House, which would completely undermine the rest of the Biden administration. And also in the Senate, they have called the For the People Act SB1 to show the same thing, that it is a top priority for Senate Democrats. And they will face a challenge on this in the next weeks. And one of the things I think is interesting, David, I've read Kill Switch, Adam Gentleson's book, and I was also doing a little research on my own. One of the people who filibustered, did a talking filibuster of the 1964 Civil Rights Act, talked for over 14 hours, was Robert Byrd from West Virginia, the direct predecessor to Joe Manchin. So this is not ancient history of using the filibuster to prevent, you know, civil rights legislation. It was done by the guy whose seat Joe Manchin took. Now, Byrd did change his ways, but this is history, and this is the history of Joe Manchin's Senate seat.
Yeah, and it is really important to note that Robert Byrd had just a wholesale conversion in his views on civil rights and so many other issues. But the interesting thing as well about Robert Byrd is that he himself believed that it was entirely permissible for the Senate to operate by majority rule. And in fact, one of his most notable or maybe notorious legacies is the budget reconciliation process that we just went through to pass the amazing rescue plan for COVID relief. And that obviously passed with just a simple majority vote. Joe Manchin had no problem supporting that. And not only that, it's insanely popular. Republicans have no idea how to oppose it. But here's the thing. The Republic still stands. The fact that this bill passed the Senate with a simple majority has not undermined our Republican form of government. In fact, my very strong belief is that it only buttresses it and makes it stronger.
So true. So true. And you know, I know the filibuster, the history of the filibuster is that it has changed repeatedly. But, you know, Joe Manchin sponsored one of the background check bills, gun background checks bills, along with Pat Toomey. Now, the House of Representatives last week passed a background check bill. It's supported by about 90%+ of the American people. You don't get a bigger consensus than that. His bill was filibustered. I used to work on the gun issue. You know, we're up against the NRA. Let me tell you, the Brady bill wasn't filibustered. The federal assault weapon ban passed with a majority vote as an amendment back in 1994. We passed a gun show loophole bill in the Senate by a 51-50 vote in 99, and we passed a couple of bills. We got a couple of positive votes in the Senate in 2004. Now, not all of them became law, but it just shows in the not too distant past on the gun issue, you know, one of the most contentious issues, we were able to win on straight majority votes.
Yeah. And, you know, Joe Manchin is going to have to decide, of course, whether he wants to just, if the bill gets filibustered again, which Republicans almost certainly will do, then he's going to have to decide whether he is simply going to give up in the face of that obstruction. And what he has said is that, you know, he believes that this process is a chance for the minority to make a bill better. Okay, make the bill better. Tell us how to make the bill better, and then vote for it. But of course, what we're seeing is Republicans aren't doing any such thing. And there have been a couple of really egregious examples with the COVID relief bill of Republicans who voted against it because they all voted against it, and now trying to take credit for the parts of it they liked. Yes. We saw Roger Wicker, senator from Mississippi, do that last week. We saw Maria Elvira Salazar, a freshman congresswoman from Florida, also do the same thing. So it seems based on a flawed premise that the minority is ever going to want to make the bill better, at least the current Republican minority. They don't really have an interest in good faith governance. And so, you know, we'll see whether Manchin would rather keep the filibuster or would rather have legislative priorities passed into law. And also, I want to note that it's not just Manchin. There are a few other sort of, you know, old school, maybe quote unquote traditionalists who also have a lot of skepticism about this. But let's see what happens with H.R. 1, because the Senate is going to hold hearings on that very soon. It was this month, I believe, it will come up for a vote, you know, again, pretty soon. And then what happens? You know, the ball will really be in Democrats' court at that point.
Absolutely right. And, you know, and again, I think it's important to note that the pieces of legislation that the Democrats are moving forward, you know, the background check bill, H.R. 1, the DREAM Act this week, these are all bills that have a national consensus behind them. It is, they are overwhelmingly supported, as was the American Rescue Plan. And we saw with the American Rescue Plan, the numbers are off the charts in terms of support, and we were able to get it 51-50. Not one Republican voted for it. And one of I want to change the subject on this because I got so many things I want to talk to you about. But one other thing that gave me great joy, David Neer, and you'll appreciate this, and I know your colleague Joan McCarter felt the same way, was when Chuck Schumer said last week, we're not playing Susan Collins' game anymore because we played that game in 2009. And Susan Collins is someone who purports to be bipartisan, but I've always felt she was a stalking horse for McConnell to get out there and try and weaken Democratic legislation and then not vote for it anyway. So I was so great to see that exposed. Of course, there was a, you know, DC political media were agog because they believe she's bipartisan, but it's bullshit.
Of course. You know, she had this funny response where she more or less accused Chuck Schumer of having Collins derangement syndrome. She was so furious about him for, you know, the campaign that he helped support against her last year in Maine. And I thought, well, this is great. I hope Susan Collins is right. If Chuck Schumer does have Susan Collins derangement syndrome, then he's not going to waste a single moment of his time for the next 2 years on her. Great. Let's keep moving forward.
Let's keep moving forward. And, you know, speaking of the Senate, David, what's been really fascinating to me, how many Republican senators are retiring this year? Now, granted, they're not in blue states, but they, you know, the latest one was Roy Blunt from Missouri, who's just basically said, can't do it anymore. He's only been in for two terms. Talk a little bit about what's happening in the Senate with the Republican caucus.
Yeah, so far we have five Republican Senate retirements, and, you know, several of them are in states that Democrats can potentially win, particularly the main two are Pennsylvania and North Carolina. So those are open seats now. You know, studies have shown that the number of Senate retirements doesn't necessarily correlate all that well with the number of pickups for the other party. A lot of Republicans, for instance, retired heading into the 2010 elections, which, of course, turned out to be a total rout for them. But, you know, someone like Roy Blunt or Rob Portman in Ohio, or certainly Pat Toomey in Pennsylvania, you know, these guys are not, you know, they're young for the Senate, shall we say. And if they were having fun and if they thought that they were going to win back the majority, you know, next year, wouldn't they stick around and enjoy their committee chairmanships and perks and, you know, the chance to rule the roost? And the answer seems to be no. And I think that a big part of it is this sort of modern Republican Party really doesn't care at all about legislating and governance and getting anything done. And it just cares about owning the libs on Twitter. And in fact, I saw a quote from Madison Cawthorn, who, of course, everyone knows as the pro-Nazi rep from North Carolina, freshman Republican. And he said, I mean, I'd be quoting this exactly, but he said, you know, that he plans to run his congressional office more about comms and less about legislation, more about communications and less about legislation. And that really says everything, that all they want to do is get on Fox News or maybe these days Newsmax, you know, get the tweets that get 10,000 retweets or whatever. And that's all they really care about. And even if you're an ultra conservative guy like Pat Toomey or Roy Blunt, you know, I don't think that's what they signed up to go to Washington for.
Right. I think that's right. And, you know, look, North Carolina, Pennsylvania provide opportunities. Ohio, you know, we do have a good progressive populist Democratic senator, Sherrod Brown, who last won in 2018. And I think whoever runs for that seat should model themselves on them. And I was looking at the numbers from Missouri. And interestingly about Missouri is that there have been a number of very progressive ballot initiatives. You know, Medicare expansion did better in Missouri than Claire McCaskill did. And towards the end of her campaign in 2018, McCaskill had really moved very much to the right, I thought. And that was a good Democratic year. In 2016, Jason Kander ran in Missouri against Roy Blunt, ran a very progressive campaign. Very progressive campaign, never changed his message anywhere. He actually did better in Missouri than McCaskill did. And, you know, a point or two, but, you know, I think it shows, doesn't help in a state like Missouri, where Harry Truman basically said famously to the Americans for Democratic Action, you know, if you give people a choice between a Republican and a Republican, they choose the Republican every time. So hopefully, right, going into 2022, Democrats will look for candidates that model more Jason Kander and certainly in Ohio, Sherrod Brown.
Yeah, I definitely think that Sherrod Brown and Jason Kander are both great models for candidates. But, you know, the thing about the ballot measures is sort of a really poignant problem for liberals. We have seen countless progressive ballot measures pass in very red states, often by large margins, so sometimes small margins, that otherwise would never elect a Democrat. I mean, Oklahoma also passed Medicaid expansion last year. And, you know, obviously forget about trying to win a Senate seat there. You know, we've seen the minimum wage, marijuana legalization, all manner of bills like that pass in places like Florida, Arizona, tax hikes as well. And it just speaks to our polarization, just how sharply divided things are along partisan lines when people are voting for politicians, candidates with party labels attached to them. And but when party labels are suddenly removed, like a ballot measure to hike the minimum wage, then people, you know, sort of retreat from their tribal identifications and are able to see the idea on its own, which is part of why, incidentally, so many Republican legislatures are trying to make it harder for progressives to get measures on the ballot, because they know it's a great end run around these, you know, do-nothing legislatures that won't, for instance, increase the minimum wage. But I saw a funny little Twitter joke after that Oklahoma Medicaid expansion passed last year and said, you know, Joe Biden should run as a ballot measure. you know, he'd win 70% of the vote.
Well, it's really true. And I mean, Florida in 2020, the, you know, minimum wage got over 60% of the vote. And I followed it pretty closely because we, you know, we follow that stuff, and especially at the state level. And one of the things afterwards, I saw a critique from Anna Escamani, who's a state rep from Orlando, who I've interviewed several times. She's amazing. And she said, you know, the Florida Democratic Party writ large did not lean in on that issue, partly because some of their big funders were opposed to it. And I thought that was really interesting that, you know, the Democratic Party didn't lean in on a very progressive and important issue that won overwhelmingly. And then I was thinking about that same thing as we were watching the debate in the Senate last week when, you know, there was a measure to add back the $15 minimum wage. And all I could think of was, David, was like, Democrats spend hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars to win Florida. That campaign spent $6 million and got 60% of the vote. That should be a signal to Democrats around the country. These are popular issues, support popular issues that A, help people, which is important, and B, people want. So, you know, It's I don't understand the disconnect sometimes, but hopefully we'll continue to hit away on issues like the $15 minimum wage, and eventually it will happen, and it should even be higher.
Well, you know, I think the Florida Democratic Party, I think, is not emblematic of what we're seeing with D.C. Democrats, because D.C. Democrats, the Biden administration, both chambers of Congress, really not only have they learned their lesson from, especially from the Obama administration, but they've been saying out loud, we learned our lesson, you know, and embrace the popular stuff, push the popular stuff. And they're definitely doing it. And I really think the Republicans are back on their heels. You know, Biden and his whole team are about to embark on this sort of massive cross-country publicity tour, essentially, for the COVID bills. But it's also an educational tour. There are so many parts of it that, you know, we want Americans to take advantage of. And people need to be educated about it. And so it's sort of a real twofer, both education and PR. And I think, you know, the polls are going to show this bill staying as popular or only getting more popular. I don't think it's going to have the trajectory of the stimulus and the ACA.
It's so important, David. I talked about that a little at the top of the show. The president did a press conference today. The vice president's in Las Vegas, and she's heading to California. So important for them to own it. And it has thrown the Republicans off because they're so used to being able to water the package down and to slow things down. And they didn't this year. It was a marked change from what happened, as you said, in 2009, which we were all pulling our hair out. And this year, Democrats did learn their lesson and they're owning it. It is, David, before I let you go, an election year in 2021. And you are tracking, of course, at Daily Coast. And everybody, if you care about politics, and I say this every time David's on, but sign up for the Daily Coast Elections Morning Digest, dailycoast.com/morningdigest. Every day around 8:15, you'll get an email that goes through all the races. Federal, state, local, and you will be up to speed. It is an awesome document. So 2021, what's on the ballot?
So normally here I would start talking about Virginia and how this might finally be the year where Democrats turn Virginia blue. Oh wait, we already did that in 2020. So now this year is going to be the year where Democrats try to protect their majority in the state house. The Senate's not up, and also to keep their hold on the governor's mansion. But what I want to stress is a different election in a different state, and that is an open seat race for the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. Supreme Court races have, for the last several years, been my number one hobby horse. They do not get nearly enough attention compared to what they should get, and in particular from the left, because the right has been devoting tons and tons of money to these races in states across the country for many years, getting extremely conservative, hard right ideologues on the bench, and they vote in favor of voting restrictions and, you know, basically, you know, anything that their corporate masters want them to support, you know, in the legal arena. And in cases, however, where Democrats or progressives have managed to take majorities on these state Supreme Courts, we've seen just night and day. And Pennsylvania was particularly important in 2018 because Democrats took back the bench there. And then the judges, the justices, relying on the state constitution, found that the congressional map, which was a Republican partisan gerrymander, violated the state constitution, and they instituted a much fairer map. And this was happening basically a few months before the U.S. Supreme Court said, oh, no, we can't police partisan gerrymandering. But, you know, the state courts can do whatever they want to do. So Democrats have a 5-2 majority on the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. It's not under threat this year, but they could expand it to 6-1 because it's a Republican open seat. And there are about 9 other states with Supreme Court elections next year that really, really matter, including, you know, courts that could slip away from progressives, courts that progressives could pick up. So I just want the folks listening in to just keep state Supreme Court races on their mind. Like I said, they don't get a lot of attention, but they really, really should. And also, you know, the budgets for these races are much, much smaller than for a Senate race, for instance. So if you donate $10 to a state Supreme Court race, that candidate, you know, it's going to get much bigger bang for the buck than for a Senate candidate. So please, please, please pay attention to these.
Absolutely right. So important. David Near, thank you so much for talking to us today. At David Near on Twitter. Follow him. Follow Daily Kos. Follow DK Elections and sign up for the newsletter because you can keep track of all the races, including those all important state Supreme Court races. Thank you so much, David. It's always great to talk to you.
Fantastic, Joe. Talk to you soon.
Take care. This is Joe Sudbay. We're going to take a very quick break. We'll be back in just a few minutes.
The Michelangelo Signorile Show.